Hello everyone. In this video, I'll discuss CMOS inverter voltage transfer characteristics and some associated definitions. Let's get started. Before diving into inverter transfer characteristics, let's first review the operation of NMOS and PMOS transistors. For an NMOS transistor, we'll denote terminals as S for source, D for drain, and G for gate. The drain current is I sub D. The operation of NMOS can be divided into three regions based on the voltages applied to the gate, source, and drain terminal. When the voltage between gate and source, VGS, is less than the threshold voltage of the NMOS, denoted here as VTN, no current flows through the device. The MOS transistor is said to be in cutoff region. As a quick refresher, the threshold voltage is the minimum voltage required to create a conductive channel under the gate, allowing current to flow between source and drain. The next two regions are active regions. When VGS, the voltage between gate and source, is more than the threshold voltage, a conducting channel forms between the source and drain, and there is a current flow. Depending on the value of VDS, the voltage between drain and source, the active region can be classified as linear or triode region and saturation region. If VDS is less than VGS minus threshold voltage, the NMOS is in linear or triode region. The drain current in this region is given as mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VTN times VDS minus VDS square by 2. Here, the drain current ID increases linearly with VDS. On the other hand, if VDS is more than or equals to VGS minus threshold voltage, the NMOS enters saturation region. In this region, the drain current ID does not depend on VDS. The current attains a maximum value for a given gate voltage. The drain current is computed as mu n C aux W by L times VGS minus VTN whole square. The figure in this slide shows the drain current for different values of VDS and VGS voltages. The blue dashed line separates the triode or linear region and saturation region. The region on the left of the blue line is linear region and on the right is saturation region. As mentioned earlier, we can observe in the figure that in triode region or linear region, the drain current is directly proportional to the VDS voltage for a given VGS. While in saturation region, the channel is saturated with majority charge carriers and drain current is independent of VDS. The drain current is governed only by VGS and it remains constant for any given VDS. If we increase VGS voltage from VGS 1 to VGS 2, then the drain current increases for a certain VDS voltage. Similar to NMOS, PMOS transistor also operate in three regions, cutoff, triode or linear region, and saturation region. While the basic characteristic remains same as for NMOS, there are some differences. For PMOS, the threshold voltage, denoted here as VTP, is negative. The transistor is in cutoff region when gate-to-source voltage, VGS, is greater than the negative threshold voltage. It means no channel is formed and no current flows between source and drain. A conducting channel forms in PMOS when VGS is smaller than the negative threshold voltage. If VDS is greater than VGS minus VTP, the PMOS operates in linear region, where the current flow is approximately linear with applied drain voltage. When VDS is less than or equal to VGS minus VTP, the PMOS enters the saturation region. In this region, the current saturates and does not depend on VDS anymore. Now let's move on to CMOS inverter. First, the schematic. A CMOS inverter consists of two transistors, a PMOS and an NMOS. The gate terminals of PMOS and NMOS are connected together, and this is input node PIN. The drain terminals of both PMOS and NMOS are connected with each other, and this forms the output node Vout. The source terminal of PMOS is connected to power supply VDD, and the source terminal of NMOS is connected to ground, which is at 0 volt. Additionally, a load capacitor denoted as C load is connected at the output terminal, V out. In the CMOS inverter, an input voltage VIN of T is applied to the gate terminal at node VIN, which drives the inverter. Let's summarize the terminal voltages for NMOS. VG, the voltage at gate, is VIN. VS is 0 and VD is V out. VGSN is VIN minus 0, that is VIN. VDSN, the voltage between drain and source of NMOS is V out minus 0 or V out. For PMOS, VG equals to VIN, VS equals to VDD, and VD equals to V out. VGS for PMOS is VIN minus VDD, and VDS for PMOS is V out minus VDD. Now that we understand the voltages at the terminals of NMOS and PMOS, let's explore the voltage transfer characteristic of CMOS inverter. To make it easier to follow, I have put a table summarizing the operating conditions of the PMOS and NMOS transistors across their three different regions and also corresponding terminal voltages in the inverter circuit. The graph here illustrates the voltage transfer curve of a CMOS inverter. The input voltage VIN is plotted on the x-axis while the output voltage VOUT is on y-axis. This curve demonstrates how the output voltage changes as the input voltage varies over time. Starting from 0 on the x-axis, when VIN equals to 0, the output voltage VOUT is at VDD. As VIN increases from 0, but it is less than VTN, that is NMOS threshold voltage, the NMOS is in cutoff region. For PMOS, the VGS is less than VTP. Remember, VTP for PMOS is negative, so PMOS is on. We can see that for PMOS, VGSP is VIN minus VDD. VIN is a very small value in this case. So VGSP is a much less value compared to VTP, and PMOS is on. Additionally, VDS for PMOS is greater than VGSP minus VTP, putting PMOS in linear region. This we can find out that VDSP is Vout minus VDD. Vout is a value closer to VDD, so VDS is a value close to 0, while VGSP is much larger negative value, and thus VDSP is more than VGSP minus VTP. This region is highlighted in pink in the graph. Now let's look at the other end of the graph. When VIN is between VDD plus VTP and VDD, the output voltage in this case is nearly 0. PMOS is in cutoff region as VGS is greater than VTP. If we observe for PMOS, VGS is VIN minus VDD. Since VIN is a value close to VDD, VGS is almost near 0. The NMOS is on because VGS is greater than VTN. In this case, VGS is VIN, which is a high value and much higher compared to the threshold voltage. Further, the NMOS is in linear region because VDS is less than VGS minus VTN in this case. VDS is Vout, which is nearly 0, while VGS is nearly VDD. So VDSN is a much smaller value compared to VGS minus VTN, and NMOS is in linear region. This segment of graph is highlighted in blue. Let's determine how long the NMOS remains in linear region. The condition for NMOS to stay in linear region is VDS is less than VGS minus VTN. Using the terminal voltages of NMOS, this translates to Vout less than Vin minus VTN. Let's find out what this relation means on the graph. The equation Vout equals to Vin minus VTN forms a line with a slope of positive 1 intersecting the x-axis on VTN, shown here with the blue dashed line. Since the condition is Vout less than VIN minus VTN, the NMOS is in linear region up to the section highlighted in red. And beyond this point on the graph, the NMOS enters the saturation and it is in saturation all the way up to green section. Now let's determine what region is PMOS in this section highlighted in red when the NMOS is in linear region. Until the blue section in the graph, the PMOS is in cutoff region. As VIN decreases further in the direction, it is smaller than VDD plus VTP and the PMOS is on, as VGS becomes more negative than VTP. Also, VDS is less than VGSP minus VTP, as Vout is a small value and VN is almost near VDD. So VDS is more negative compared to VGS minus VTP for PMOS and it transitions to saturation region. Now let's come back to the section highlighted in pink, where NMOS is in cutoff and PMOS is in linear. And let's find out at what point PMOS transitions to saturation from linear region. The condition for PMOS to be in saturation region is VDS less than VGS minus VTP. Substituting the terminal voltages, this becomes Vout minus VDD less than Vin minus VDD minus VTP. Simplifying, we get the equation Vout less than Vin minus VTP. When we visualize this condition on this voltage transfer curve, the equation Vout equals to Vin minus VTP represents a line with slope of plus 1 intersecting the x-axis at VTP on the negative side, as VTP is a negative value shown here with the dashed red line. Since the condition is Vout less than Vin minus VTP, the PMOS transitions to saturation region where the red dashed line intersects the graph. Before this, PMOS is in linear region. We see there is a portion of the graph where both NMOS and PMOS are in saturation region. During this duration, CMOS inverter has very high static participation. So this is the voltage transfer curve of a CMOS inverter showing the operating regions of PMOS and NMOS transistors across different sections of the curve. This curve is important to understand other related definitions to CMOS inverter. For example, noise margins. Noise margin refers to the amount of noise that a CMOS circuit can tolerate without any error in the operation of the circuit. There are several factors that contribute to noise in circuits. For example, power supply fluctuations, operating environment conditions, or on-chip crosstalk from neighboring wires. A sufficient noise margin ensures reliable circuit operation by guaranteeing that a logic 1 signal, even with added noise, is still recognized as logic 1, and a logic 0 signal, even with added noise, still recognized as logic 0. We can calculate the noise margin values for a CMOS inverter using its voltage transfer curve. To do this, we first identify the points on the transfer curve with slope equals to minus 1. Let's label these points as A and B. We then find out the input voltages and the output voltage corresponding to these points. For point A, input voltage is VIL and output voltage is VOH. And for point B, input voltage is VIH and output voltage is VOL. Once we find these points, we can define noise margin high as VOH minus VIH and noise margin low as VIL minus VOL. These margins define the acceptable voltage ranges for logical high and logical low signal, ensuring reliable CMOS inverter operation under noisy conditions. Let's understand the noise margins in practical context. Consider a circuit with a driving device and a receiving device. It's important to ensure that the voltage of the driving device for a logic high, VOH, is more than the input voltage of logic high, VIH, of the receiving device.
It is important because
due to the noise, the logic high at the output may arrive with some reduced voltage at the input, but a significant noise margin ensures it is still recognized as a logical high at the receiving device. Similarly, the voltage output of a driving device for logic low, VOL, must be low compared to the input voltage of logic low of the receiving device, shown here as VIL.
It is important because
due to the noise in the wires, a logic low signal at the output may arrive at the input of the receiving device with an increased value. But with sufficient noise margin, we can make sure that it is still recognized as logical low in the receiving device. Smaller noise margins indicate that the circuit is more sensitive to noise, increasing the likelihood of errors. By including sufficient noise margins in the design, CMOS circuits can maintain an error-free operation even in noisy environments. Another important insight from the voltage transfer curve is the effect of relative strength or sizing of the PMOS and NMOS devices on the overall behavior of the CMOS inverter. We can analyze this by observing the effect of PMOS and NMOS strength on transfer characteristics. We can compare the relative strength of PMOS and NMOS by computing the ratio of mu P Cox WP over LP and mu N Cox WN over LN.
Here, mu p and mu n are the effective mobilities of the PMOS and NMOS. Cox is gate oxide capacitance per unit area. WP and WN are the gate width of the PMOS and NMOS, respectively. LP and LN are the gate lengths of the PMOS and NMOS, respectively. Now let's understand how this ratio affects the voltage transfer curve. When the ratio is increased, the VTC curve shifts to right. This is because PMOS is stronger than the NMOS, and a stronger PMOS pulls the output voltage towards VDD for longer duration, meaning the inverter output remains at the logic high for a longer period of time. When the ratio decreases, the PMOS gets weaker compared to NMOS, and this causes the output voltage to be pulled to logic low much faster and transitioning from high to low more quickly. Therefore, the sizing of the PMOS and NMOS directly impacts the switching characteristics of the CMOS inverter, such as the rise and fall times of the output voltage. This is all for this video. I hope this discussion helps you to understand the CMOS inverter voltage transfer curve, noise margin high, noise margin low, and the effect of PMOS and NMOS device sizing on inverter behavior.